Well, good morning. Go ahead and stand with us if you would. We're excited to worship together today. Would you pray with me today? God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the breath in our lungs this morning. Thank you for the opportunity to worship. To make much of you today. Father, we're on our knees declaring your praises. Declaring our dependence upon you today. Thank you, Jesus, for your steadfastness. Thank you for your love, for your faithfulness. This is the day that you have made, and we're going to choose to rejoice and be glad in it, and to give you glory and honor. In Jesus' name. Darkness. God, we just make up in our mind today that we're going to worship you. We're going to come into this place for no other reason, no other agenda, but to ascribe to you all glory and honor that you deserve. And we just worship you through song. And right now we're going to worship you through communion as we take a piece of bread and a cup of juice and we focus on the sacrifice that you made for us, that your son Jesus willingly went to a cross and paid the penalty for our sins, making a way for us, paying the penalty for my sin. So grateful, God, so grateful. Give you thanks in Jesus' name, amen. You can go ahead and have a seat, and when you're ready, go ahead and take communion.
Oh, God, my God, I need you now. Almighty river, come and fill me again.
Heavenly Father, we lift these prayers up to you today and thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, and everybody together says, amen, amen. You guys can have a seat. Welcome to Community Christian Church on this Super Sunday. We are excited for what today brings. We're excited to celebrate here today in person, online as well. Thank you for joining us as we come together to declare praises to the same God that created all heaven and earth right here, right now, today. We love that. We love doing that every single week. So thank you for joining us. We've got a connect card for those of you in person. It's in the seat back right in front of you. Here's what you do with that. You let us know any informational changes. You can fill that out. You can sign up for some things on the bottom. There are some prayer request lines. Or if you want to write in who you want to win to the Super Bowl, we'll kind of see who... what happens? Just go ahead and write Detroit Lions on the bottom. We know everybody wanted them, so I appreciate that. If you could take those out to any lobby, there's an offering box waiting for you. On the way out at the end of the service, unless you're a first-time guest, welcome to Community Christian Church. We would love it if you wouldn't mind filling out that connect card. You take it out to the center lobby. It's a connecting point table waiting for you on the right-hand side. We have a gift for you. It's a way of saying thank you. You just take that connect card right there. And we'll get that gift to you. Now, if you're new watching online, go ahead and text the word new to that number right there. And we'll get that gift out to you in the mail. So we have to talk about Friday night, guys. Friday night, night to shine. Absolutely incredible evening. We had over 200 volunteers welcome, so many honored guests that came onto our campus, and we had the opportunity to have so much fun. We're talking about limo rides and getting dressed up and eating food together and singing and karaoke, and of course a whole lot of dancing and smiling and having an absolute blast. We believe here at Community Christian Church, every single person is created in the image of God, and we are so honored to be able to do something like that and serve those kids, young adults, and families. So our generosity made that possible. You guys played a part. Some of you were here volunteering, but your giving, your generosity helped that become a reality for those families. So thank you, thank you, thank you. Came prepared to give today. Again, offering boxes in every single lobby on your way out. You can put the connect cards and your tithes and offerings in there. Always go to communitycc.com/give and give online right there as well. One last thing real quick before we watch a video. Let me talk to you about Rooted. Rooted, some of you guys have been through it, some of you haven't. Here's what Rooted is. It's a 10-week spiritual, I call it an adventure, an experience where you will start today, actually, is the Rooted kickoff, a little play on words, launch. All right, right after the 11:15 service. If you haven't signed up yet, you can just come on back, go upstairs. We'll get you signed in. We'll get you in a group, all right? But for the next 10 weeks, you get to figure out who God is, who the church is, and I love this one. What is your purpose? What are you supposed to do with your life, right? So here's who Rooted is for, right? Some of you guys have been through Rooted, but if you haven't, I encourage you, sign up, get involved. We got groups, all kinds of groups, all kinds of times. But maybe you're like, I don't know who God is yet. Rooted's perfect. If you're just beginning your spiritual journey, Rooted is where you need to plug in. But maybe you've been going to church for decades and you kind of feel stuck, you plateaued. You're like, I haven't felt God's presence in a while. Let me tell you, Rooted is for you as well. It'll jumpstart your spiritual journey back on track. So if you haven't been to Rooted yet, get plugged in. Today, upstairs in the loft, right after the 11:15 service, you can sign up up there. You can go online. We have an online group too. Going to meet on Wednesdays at 7, but you can go to communitycc.com/groups. Boom, sign up right there, or just come to the Rooted launch today. All right, we've got a night of worship coming up. Watch this video.
Hey, I'm Craig. This is my buddy Sam, worship leader at our Pompano Beach Lighthouse Point campus and for our students.
Hi, I'm so glad to be on the team, and I'm excited to announce a night of worship coming up on Friday, February 16th at 7 p.m.
And we get a lot out of these nights because pursuing and worshiping Jesus together, it's powerful and it should leave us changed. But this night is not for you. It's not for me, it's for him.
That's right. We don't come to get, we come to give. We come to surrender. We come to let go. We come to lift up his name. We come asking and we come praising. We come to worship.
We started this year in prayer together, and hopefully that began this deeper pursuit of Jesus in you. Join us for this night as we continue in that pursuit, exalting his name together.
We hope to see you on February 16th.
Well, good morning. How are you guys doing today? You guys doing well? So glad that you're here. If you're here in person, want to welcome those of you that are watching online as well. And I just want to say, Tamarack, let's give a big shout out to our Pompano Beach Lighthouse Point campus. We love you guys. We love you guys. Well, you already heard from Tim that today is a big day. There's a little football game going on tonight, the Super Bowl. I just found out that the Dolphins are not playing tonight. What a disappointment. I got to tell you. The reason I'm doing this is because it was a year ago today that I made a very bold prediction. I predicted that the Miami Dolphins would be going to this year's Super Bowl. And to clarify, I did not say that they would be playing in this year's Super Bowl. I said they would be going to this year's Super Bowl. So when you watch the game tonight, when they have a cutaway to Tua or Tyreek Hill or Larry Zonka from the 72 team, he's going to be there presenting the Lombardi Trophy. The Dolphins will be at the Super Bowl. Okay, all right, I blew that prediction. I'm just going to own up to it. I predicted, and if they would have won just a few more games, you know, like three, they would be playing in the Super Bowl. Lori and I are going to see Journey tomorrow night, and they have a song, Don't Stop Believing, and I'm not stopping believing. They're going to the Super Bowl next year. Next year, I'm predicting. Next year. It's always next year. It's always next year. So Lori and I are going, and I've got the best wife on the planet because this summer, she came back from a trip, and she gave me the best gift ever that I've ever received. She gave me a 1972 Miami Dolphins Super Bowl ring that I am wearing right now. It's incredible. The Miami Dolphins undefeated season, 1972. Bring up the slide. You can see it on the side. This is photos that I took. You can see there it says Miami Dolphins World Champions. It says Super Bowl 7, 17, and 0. And it has a score, how they beat the Redskins. And it gets better because every single one of the rings from 1972 were personalized. And she tracked down the ring from Jake Scott. You say, who's he? He's the MVP of that Super Bowl is who he was. He was the safety. When does a safety ever become MVP? He got two interceptions. So as we go to the next slide, you can see at the top, it says Scott. That's my ring. That's my ring. And if you were to go online, the Jake Scott Super Bowl ring is worth $138,000. That's what this ring would be worth if it was authentic. But it's a replica, and she got it for 15 bucks at a flea market. So I love it even more. It's the best. It's the best. So, okay, enough of that foolishness. Okay, let's get to some more foolishness. Okay, San Francisco 49ers are playing against the Kansas City Chiefs tonight. So let's hear it. How many of you are pulling for the San Francisco 49ers? Let's hear it. How many of you are pulling for the Kansas City Chiefs and Taylor Swift tonight? Oh, I'm actually surprised. How many of you deep down don't really care? Just okay. And I'm adding a fourth category that I've never added before. How many of you, if you got your way, you would want both teams to lose? I wanted the Ravens. I wanted the Lions. This is not the Super Bowl that I wanted, but it's the Super Bowl that I got. So for, I don't know, 15, 17 years, I've been making Super Bowl predictions based on the Bible on who's going to win. Now, 4 years ago, the San Francisco 49ers played against the Kansas City Chiefs, and I'm a Bible scholar, and so I found a verse of scripture that I used for my prediction 4 years ago, and it is 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 4. It says, "And when the chief shepherd appears, you'll receive the crown of glory that will never fade away." And I predicted that the Kansas City Chiefs would win the Super Bowl 4 years ago, and they did, based on the Bible. So how could I not make the same prediction this year based on the Bible? They won 4 years ago. But as Lee Corso of College Game Day is famous for saying, "Not so fast, my friends." As I was looking at that verse, it says when the chief shepherd appears. It doesn't say that the chief shepherd will receive the crown. I think I misinterpreted that verse. I just got lucky. It wasn't the Bible at all. So I spent more time this week looking at the Bible, and I found an obscure prophecy way back in the Old Testament. And here it is, Leviticus chapter 25, verse 8. It says, you must count off 7 Sabbath years, 7 sets of 7 years, adding up to what? To 49. There it is in the Bible right there. And then when you get to the 49, then blow the ram's horn loud and long throughout the land. Friends, that's indisputable. It's obvious to me that there's going to be a huge victory for the San Francisco 49ers tonight over the Chiefs based on the Bible. It's just right there. I'm almost done. There will be no guests that ever return from this Sunday. I know that. It's like, I'm required to read this disclaimer by our attorney every year, okay? Do not bet on this game based on this prediction of the Bible. Here's what they require me to read. Please do not bet on any money on this prediction in quotes. What's that? That's insulting. On this prediction, Pastor Scott is usually wrong with these prophecies. Last year, he predicted that the Eagles would win the Super Bowl, and that did not turn out very well for them. So anyway, all right, I'm done. I'm ready to jump into the message now, but it should be a fun game. And we were talking about, is it possible for both of them to tie a scoreless game, the worst Super Bowl in history? It's always possible. So anyway, but I'll be watching the game. Well, last Sunday, I was with you guys at Pompano Beach Lighthouse Point, and I shared some great news for us personally. Lori and I celebrated our 7th grandchild coming into the world. It was awesome. This happened on Friday, February the 2nd, little David Alexander, not little, I mean, 9 pounds, 4 ounces. And David is the only one of our 7 grandkids that was born through a home birth. I mean, who does that? Alex, our daughter-in-law did a home birth for little David. And so we can't wait to see him hopefully sometime real soon. So now David is the son of our oldest son, Chris. And when Chris was 4 years old, he was the funniest kid. And he was in a preschool class, and his teacher was a good friend of ours. He was one of the pastor's wives of the church that we were at in Clearwater at the time. And Carol Skinner told us this story that Chris got in trouble. You know, he did something. I don't know what classroom rule that he broke. It wasn't a felony, but he was on the other side of the class. It was a big room. And he didn't think that Carol, you know, saw him. And he did something, and she yelled out, "Christopher, Christopher." And he just kind of ignored, and he said, "Christopher." And he turned around, and she said, so Christopher walked over to Carol, and she just simply said, "Christopher, tell me what you did." And Carol told us that Chris, he paused, and he said, "Well, first, you tell me what you saw." 4 years old, not making that up. And being his dad was a journey. I'm not kidding. It was a lot of fun, this little strategic mind. I mean, he didn't want to commit to more than he had to. And a lot of us are like that sometimes. We don't want to commit to more than we have to. But Chris saw the bigger lesson for me. He saw there was a connection between seeing and doing. He did. What did you do? Well, tell me what you saw. There's a connection between seeing and doing. And I want to talk to you about that today. Because there ought to be a connection between what we see and then what we do as a result of what we see, what we do. When we see what Jesus has done for us, it compels us. It compels us out of a sense of gratitude to serve him, to honor him, to love him. And we want to be a serving church. And this is an incredible serving church. It just is. So this is not a problem, but it's always best to talk about something that's not a problem so that it doesn't become a problem. But so it becomes, it continues to be a part of the DNA and the culture of this church that we are a serving church. Because sometimes people think that church is all about them, that church is designed to cater to them. And church leaders sometimes can fall into this consumer mindset and not challenging people, but just placating people. Check out this video on the screen.
Imagine a church where every member is passionately, wholeheartedly, and recklessly calling the shots.
I don't know who sets the worship center temperature, but why does it have to be so cold?
Why do you have to be so right? Heated chairs are now being installed.
This one wants a small church, but I'm afraid if it's too small, they're gonna make me volunteer like crazy. And I don't stack chairs, do I?
Makes total sense. Join now and we'll let you decide the size of our church.
We're millennials and we want a church that...
Say no more. Any requests you have will be granted immediately.
Parking is horrible. It takes me almost 6 minutes to get from my car to the building. Ugh.
It's gonna take me 6 seconds to tell you a valet service is on the way.
My pastor's preaching, it's all over the map. I say, oh, I don't know, stick with the books of the Bible. We should be only exegetical.
Okay, next week we start John chapter 1, verse 1. And we'll even start pronouncing that word the way you said it.
Hey, I'd like this sermon to be no longer than 30 minutes.
How does 15 minutes sound?
Hey, anybody willing to go 15 should be willing to go to 10.
You drive a hard bargain. But from now on, 5-minute sermons it is.
Now you're talking.
Me Church, where it's all about you.
Five-minute sermon. Let's close in prayer. I don't think I'd enjoy being the pastor at that church. I mean, I just would not. There is a sign in front of a church that captured their vision, Jesus only, Jesus only. And then a storm blew through and it took off the first 3 letters of that sign and then it just flashed, us only, us only, us only. That's not Jesus' church. It's not me church, it's his church. Why would we choose in the world that is just, it's all about us, why would we choose to serve others? Why would we choose to serve the Lord? Well, first of all, we're going to jump into this. Jesus modeled it. That's why Jesus modeled it. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, before he was crucified, I mean, he knew that the cross was coming, and he was in the upper room. And before he even had that Last Supper with his disciples, with his friends, he could have had this teaching time about all of his miracles to validate his deity, the fact that he is the Messiah, the Son of the living God. But you know what Jesus chose to do? John 13, verse 5, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. So the master, he became the servant, and he calls on us to follow him. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. So we serve because Jesus modeled it. When Charles McNeely was the president of Lincoln Christian College, the school had a tradition at graduation. The president would look at each graduate in the eye and then hand them their diploma, and then he would hand them a towel. And then he would say, he would look them right in the eyes, we send you out not as a Bible scholar, but as a servant to wash the feet of the world. Jesus never asked us to do something that he was not willing to do himself. And we have a slogan around here for our staff. It says, we're not the exception. We are the example. In a few weeks, we're going to ask some of you, maybe a lot of you, to park not in the south lot or right close to the building. And we're not going to add a valet service, by the way, either. We're going to ask you to park over at Gold Coast or in our faraway lot, because on Easter Sunday, we're hoping to have 2, maybe 3 times as many people. And we don't want people that come on Easter to get frustrated trying to find a place to park. And so we're not the exception. We're the example, and that really should be the core of our entire church family, not just our staff. Jesus said in Matthew 20, verse 28, "For even I, the Son of Man, came here not to be served, but to serve others and to give my life as a ransom for many." There's an Episcopal church in Santa Fe, New Mexico, that has only one entrance into their auditorium, and someone had this handwritten sign above the door that says, "Servants' Entrance." The only way you can get in and out of that sanctuary is through the service door. There's another reason that we serve, and that's because God commands it. God commands that his followers are to serve, and he tells us how to serve. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 7 says, "Serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not men, because you know that the Lord will reward everyone for whatever good he does." So we serve wholeheartedly, and God, he commands his followers to do that. Heard about a family that had a long drive to this campsite. They were gonna camp for the weekend. And their van was just full of all kinds of camping supply, and there's four kids and the mom and the dad, and they pulled into the last remaining campsite, and when they did, the doors just opened up, and the boys, they grabbed the tent, they put it up really quickly, and then they ran to get firewood in the woods and bring it back, and the girls, they just jumped out of the car, and they're putting the cook stove together and everything required for that, and there's a guy that's at the campsite right next to him, and he's going, "I can't believe, I've never witnessed teamwork like this ever in my entire life," and the dad just kind of, you know, overseeing everything. He said, "Yeah, I've got a system. Nobody gets to go to the bathroom until the camp is set up." We're thinking about instituting that here at Community, you know, so lock the doors. God commands us to serve, but it's not coercive. He calls us to that. He equips us to that. He gifts us to do that. And when we do, when we serve out of our giftedness, it's not a burden, it is an amazing joy. A third reason to serve the Lord is because, frankly, the church needs it. The church needs it. There's a danger of a growing church. People will often say, "There's so many people, I just kind of sit on the sideline. They don't need me. I don't want to be in too small of a church where I get noticed. I certainly don't want to be stacking chairs." And here's the thing. And I get it. And if I wasn't on the inside and I was on the outside, I would think, "Wow, there's so many people, there's so many roles, there's so many people that are serving. I can just sit and then sit and soak. I don't have to do anything." But the opposite's true. The larger a church gets, the more people are needed. And the assumptions are that you're not needed, but I want to let you know that you are. You're really needed. There are so many needs that, well, truth be told, that they can go unmet. And we need hundreds of volunteers to work in our children's ministry, birth through fifth grade at Tamarack and also at Pompano Beach Lighthouse Point every single week. And there are some openings if you like kids. And if you don't like kids, there are still some openings. Not to work directly with kids, but there's a need. It was back in World War II when there's a young boy named Bobby Hill. He lived in Italy. His dad was a part of the Allied forces. His dad was a sergeant. And they were stationed in Italy. And Bobby, he read a book about Dr. Albert Schweitzer and his medical mission in Africa. And he was really impressed by what Dr. Albert Schweitzer was doing in Africa. And so he decided that he wanted to do something to help out. So he went to the PX, which is the commissary. It's the store for the military on a base. And so he went there and he bought a bottle of aspirin. Then he wrote a note to the Lieutenant General, Richard Lindsay, the commander of all the Allied forces in Europe. And he wrote in his note, and he enclosed that note with the aspirin, the pills. He said, "Sir, if any of your planes ever fly over Africa, could they parachute this bottle of aspirin down to help Dr. Schweitzer?" And the general, he was really touched by that note and that gesture, and he's told some friends about it. A radio station picked up on that, and they started to broadcast that, and then everybody started sending in medical supplies. Eventually, it was the Italian Air Force and the French Air Force that actually flew planes to Africa to drop off over $400,000 of medical supplies back in the 1940s. Now, $400,000 in 1940 is worth $100 billion today. Okay, I just made that up. I don't have any idea what it is, but it's a lot more than $400,000. And Dr. Schweitzer, he said, "I never dreamed that a little boy with a bottle of aspirin could do so much." And I wonder what you could do for the kingdom of God. Maybe somebody would be inspired by your service. Your service may inspire others to serve. What is that in your hand? Moses saw a rod, but God saw an instrument that would part the Red Sea, that would end up saving the lives of millions of Israelites. David saw a slingshot, but God saw an instrument that would prove to everyone that God is way more powerful than any giant. A young boy saw 5 loaves and 2 fish. Jesus saw a meal that would feed thousands. Paul said in Ephesians 4:11, Christ gave gifts to people. Christ gave those gifts to prepare God's holy people. What for? For the work of serving, to make the body of Christ stronger. And I don't know who originally said this, but I like the thought. I mean, it's been around for decades. What you are is God's gift to you. What you become is your gift to God. And we give back to him. It was toward the end of his life that Albert Einstein removed 2 portraits of 2 scientists from his wall. He had a portrait of Isaac Newton and then Maxwell, and he took those down and he put up a portrait of Gandhi and Albert Schweitzer, and he said, it's time. It's time to replace the image of success with the image of service. And Einstein was pretty wise. Now, what are the results of serving the Lord? I looked at 3 quick reasons on the reasons. What are the results? Well, first of all, let me say this. My concern is you'll think that this is some message that's primarily designed to get you to do something to volunteer around here. The truth is we're a volunteer organization. Okay, we are. We have a staff. We've got a great staff, but we're mostly a volunteer organization. But here's the thing. Our staff doesn't even know I'm giving this message. Sometimes we'll gear up and we'll have like a series of messages to recruit people. I just kind of felt prompted by God. I was having a conversation a few weeks ago with a pastor, and I go, you know what? I think I just need to do this. Because here's the thing. We do need some volunteers, but that's not what's driving this, because we always need volunteers. But friends, here's the thing. You need to serve more than we need you to serve. You need to serve because God created you to do that. And when you're serving in the area of your giftedness, and you're serving the creator of the universe, and you're serving out of your giftedness and your passion, there's no greater sense of significance in all of life than that. And so I want to look at some results of serving. John 13, verse 14, it says, since I, the Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet. Jesus is saying this. I've given you an example to follow, so do as I have done to you. And then verse 17, now that you know these things, you will be blessed. You will be blessed if you do them. So there are some results, some blessings that come along with this. And the first one is you're fulfilled. You have this sense of fulfillment by your connection with this church. And people around here that serve, they have this sense of fulfillment all the time. We found that volunteers who continue to serve the longest are those serving in areas where they just feel like they're gifted. And when they're gifted, they serve out of passion. Romans 12:6 says, we have different gifts according to the grace given to us. And when you're serving out of your passion and out of your giftedness, it actually energizes you rather than depletes you. And that's what we want for you. That's why we want to try to help you to serve out of your giftedness, your gifts, your talents, your abilities, and your passion. And God doesn't expect us to live constantly on the verge of physical or emotional exhaustion. Jesus said that serving God was like food for him. Jesus said, I have food to eat that you know nothing about. It was fueling him. And when you're serving out of your giftedness and your passion, it'll fuel you. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. Different gifts. You have gifts that I do not have. I have very few gifts, and that's just truth. That's not like some false humility. I've got very few. But I try to use the gifts that I do have, and we have different gifts. You have a unique mix of talents and gifts and abilities that God has given to you. And I love the sign that was on a Colorado dude ranch one time, and it said, we have horses for everybody. For fast people, we have fast horses. For slow people, we have slow horses. For big people, we have big horses. For little people, we have little horses. For people who have never ridden horses before, we have horses that have never been ridden before. I mean, we all have different unique talents and gifts, and God wants all of us together to use those. And when you do that, and you're serving out of your giftedness and your passion, it doesn't get any better than that. I know people that don't get a lot of joy from their vocation, but they get so much joy from serving the Lord at community because it's out of their passion and they're a difference maker. Second result of serving the Lord is you are encouraged by your connection with other people. You're encouraged by your connection with others. There's something that takes place when you serve alongside of other people. I mean, we see it all the time. One of our slogans here is we want everyone who believes here to feel like they belong here. Now, if you're not engaged in serving, you can only, you know, feel like you belong so much. I mean, some of us may know your name. We might kind of give you a little head nod when you come in that, and you feel like, yeah, I kind of belong, but I don't feel like I'm really belonging. All it takes is the step to get out of the stands and on to the field, and when you serve with other people, and I love what I see, some of the different ministry categories where people serve together, and our tech team, and our worship ministry, and our students, and our guest services, and all these different teams, when people serve together, they become a part of life together, and they do life, and they will get together outside of church here, and they feel like they belong here. They belong here. Paul says in Romans chapter 12, he says, just as our bodies have many parts and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We're all parts of his one body, and each of us has a different work to do. And since we are all one body in Christ, we belong to each other, and each of us, we need all the others. And the final result that I want to look at of serving the Lord is you are rewarded by your connection with Jesus. Friends, the truth is there's a level of happiness that you get in serving the Lord that you can never get when you just indulge yourself. We all know the truth of Jesus' words when he said, it is more blessed to what? To give than it is to receive. And when you give, there is this sense of fulfillment, this sense of connection, this sense of encouragement, this reward that comes by following Jesus. Jesus calls us to a different kind of a lifestyle. And when you serve on behalf of Jesus, there is a reward that is laid up for you. Jesus said in Matthew 10:42, and if you give even a cup of cold water to one of the least of my followers, you will be rewarded. And so, and that reward, frankly, is Jesus himself. It just is. And Tim already mentioned that Friday night, we had our night to shine. It was an incredible night. It just was. And over 100 honored guests were here, and they were, it was like this prom-like experience, and they were crowned kings and queens, and it was just such a special night. When you see Donna James, would you just give her a big shout-out? Let's appreciate Donna right now. She was our Night to Shine director. She just was. She just. And for the over 240 volunteers, I just want to thank you, thank you. And I was watching a lot of posts on social media yesterday. People were saying, I am absolutely exhausted from yesterday, but I am so fulfilled, so fulfilled. And for those of you that kind of fall in the category of attending but not serving, I hope that you'll sense that God's calling you to more. We need some volunteers, but we're always going to need volunteers. This isn't really about us. It really is about you. I think all of us in our better moments, we want to be difference makers, not just space takers. This is an opportunity for you to take a step and say, okay, based on my schedule right now, I don't know if I can serve every week. I don't know. Maybe it's once a month. Maybe it's like special events. There's all kinds of ways that you can get involved and you can serve around here. But it's going to take all of us to do that because we want to change the world, and we are changing the world, but we could bring about more change when more of us step out of the stands and get onto the field. And that's what I'm inviting you to. Bob Goff was here a number of years ago. He's one of my favorite writers. He's one of my favorite individuals. I got a chance to spend time with Bob. I picked him up at the airport, or I took him to the airport and spent some time with him. Just this incredible guy. He wrote, if you want to read one of the most inspiring books, it's not even going to be on the screen. Just write it down. I didn't plan on saying this. It's Love Does. And he just has this incredible life because he's just living out of a sense of just, God, what do you want me to do? And he said this. Bob said, I used to think that you had to be special for God to use you. But now I know you simply need to do what? You just need to say yes. That's all you have to do. You just simply need to say yes. Check out this video on the screen. Thank you for saying yes. We have just hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of volunteers here at Community. Thank you for saying yes. And God's calling some of you just to say yes. And we'll try to help you to find the right place to serve. A number of years ago, we developed a process to do that. It's simply called test drive. And like you go to a dealership, you're not sure what car you like. You test drive a bunch of different cars till you find the right fit for you. We let you test drive different ministries. And I want to encourage you to go ahead and take your camera out right now. You could actually, you know, put that and it'll take you to the website and you could sign up or just take a picture or you could just write down communitycc.com/test drive and you could take a test drive. No strings attached. You said, you know what? It's been years, but I'm 20 years ago. I love serving with kids and that's where I want. And you take a test drive. You go, you know what? I thought I loved kids, but I don't really like kids. He doesn't like us. She doesn't like it. You know, we don't want you serving with kids if you don't like kids. And we'll set you up for another test drive. We'll set you up for different things. And there's all kinds. There's so many different test drives. You can test drive almost every ministry at Community other than this one. I mean, yeah, hey, I'd like to preach on Sundays. You know, we got that covered for right now. So anyway, but you can test drive so many different things. And I just want you to consider that. I love what the Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 12. He said, and so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind that he will accept. And then Paul said this. He said, when you think of what he has done for you, is this too much to ask? When you think of what Jesus has done for you, is this too much to ask? I started the message after the football shenanigans with this comparison between seeing and doing. And I know what people do when I see what people have seen. And when we see a bloodstained cross, it should move us. And we don't serve out of manipulation. We don't serve out of ego. We don't serve out of, we just serve simply out of gratitude. When you think of what he has done for you, is this too much to ask? And when we serve out of gratitude, we can look forward to hearing those words from Jesus himself one day. Those six words that those of us who are followers of Jesus, we all want to hear one day. Jesus himself said in Matthew 25, he said, we can look forward to, well done. Well done, good and faithful servant. Well done. I long to hear those words one day. But here's the thing about those words. And I'm just stating the obvious. In order to hear well done, we have to be a servant. Well done, good and faithful servant. So if we want to hear those words, we have to be a servant. It's not a have to, even though God commands us to do this. I don't want you to do it out of sense of obligation or duty. It's a get to. After we see what he has done for us, how could we not serve him? Well done. Well done, good and faithful servant. And friends, when we set you up to serve in an area of ministry where you're gifted, your talents, your natural abilities, and your spiritual gifts, they mesh, and then your passion fits, and you're having this sense of fulfillment. You're not being exhausted, you're being energized, and you're having this sense of significance. And I gotta tell you, it never ever gets old, and it just is this great opportunity to be a difference maker for the King of the universe. And we get to do this. He empowers us, he leads us, he strengthens us, and he fulfills us. And all we have to do is just say yes. That's all we have to do. So let's say yes to him. Heavenly Father, we come to you today. We're grateful. Well, for the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus, but God, today I'm grateful, as I always am for that, but I'm grateful for his example, for the model of servanthood that he gave us all throughout his life. I mean, here, the King of the universe who stepped out of eternity into time and took on the role of a servant. God, help us to be more like him. He calls us to that. Father, I thank you. This is not me, church. that community is this beautiful mosaic of people from all over the world that are just serving you and honoring you. And God, I pray that that would always be our heartbeat. That would always be our church culture. God, and today we open up the door for others to join us on this serving journey. Father, I thank you for Christ Jesus, the hope of our salvation. I thank you for his grace, his forgiveness, his love, his mercy, and for his resurrection, and for one day his return. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. You guys can have a seat real quick. A couple announcements. First one, a sad one to make, but as many of you guys may have already heard, Pastor G. Gonzalo Venegas has resigned as our campus pastor for the Pompano Beach campus. You don't even know how to say this. It's been a difficult year for him after the passing of their sweet daughter, Gabby, which has led to a lot of extra health problems for him. So after a lot of prayer, they decided it best to go back home to Michigan to be around some family, to be able to heal that way as well. We love Pastor G. We love Amanda. We love their family. And so we want to let you guys know that so you could be in prayer for them as they transition back to Michigan. And also, he'll be here tonight at our 5 o'clock service due to the Super Bowl time change. So if you want to come on back and give him a big hug and pray with him and for him, he and his wife and family will be here during our 5 o'clock service as well. So thank you in advance for praying for Pastor G and his family. Want to remind you, Financial Peace University, FPU, happening very soon, starting up like this week. So there's a lot of information. It's a life-changing thing, Christian-based way to get out of debt and honor God with your finances. All the information out at the hub. It's our glass wall right there. You can grab that on the way out. But let's just talk about what's your next step. What's a decision look like for you today? Maybe you need to say yes to Jesus for the very first time, repent, be baptized. We're ready for you. Come on down. We'd love to pray with you, help you make that decision. Maybe it's a decision to get plugged in to a small group again. The Rooted launch is today after the 11:15 service. Maybe it's to say yes to serving. So however we can help you step towards Jesus, we would love to do that with you today. We'll have some people down front, love to pray with you and help you take that next step, whatever your decision may be. If you're ready for some prayer online, you can text the word prayer to that number. We'll walk with you either way towards Jesus and his kingdom. Thanks for joining us here today at Community. Hope everybody has a great week. We'll see you next Sunday.